Mr. Speaker, sir, Honourable Prime Minister, Honourable Leader of Opposition, acting Leader of Opposition or potential Leader of Opposition, Leader of NFP, Honourable Members of Parliament. Mr. Speaker, we always hear stories from our village elders about how plentiful nature was some 50 years ago when compared to the present. We now need to go further out in the sea to fish, wander further in the forest to hunt. Our traditional medicines are disappearing, the beautiful birds are declining in numbers, and we are having gradually destroying this beautiful creation through our selfish actions. Mr. Speaker, say, the precious habitats and species are disappearing from our planet faster than at any other time in human history, and we humans are the principal drivers of this loss. Through habitat conversion, over-exploitation, pollution, climate change, and the introduction of invasive alien species, we have messed up this beautiful creation. As we lose this biodiversity, we lose the food, water, medicine, and cultural, spiritual well-being it provides. It is therefore time to put our acts together and do something. We cannot just sit back, relax, and watch as endangered species are wiped out off the face of Earth by our carelessness. The speaker say, as a virus born from the wilds grinds the machineries of the economy to a halt, the COVID-19 pandemic has changed people's lives and has become a critical moment of realization for all of us. We have realized in an unforgiving way that human health is completely connected to the health of nature. We have taken nature for granted for so long. We have assumed that the season will follow season, that our fields will be planted and yield bountiful harvests, that soil will stay fertile and that life will all be well. All this, even as we continue to carelessly extract, emit, dispose effluents and exterminate nature. Given current COVID-19 crisis, I'm sure we have realized that nature matters. And if we infringe on nature, zoonotic diseases are possible with devastating socioeconomic consequences. Mr. Speaker, say, last week we celebrated the International Day for Biological Diversity under the theme of, and I quote, "Our solutions are in nature," unquote. The theme brings to the limelight the importance of a very relevant issue the world faces today. It highlights the need for us to work together with nature to secure our future in harmony with nature. We need biodiversity positive agriculture, biodiversity smart construction, and biodiversity-friendly infrastructure, integrating nature in design and execution. Speaker says the theme strongly demonstrates the need to revisit our relationship with the natural world and recognize that solutions to our problems are found in nature. It may sound radical, but no matter how technologically advanced we may be, we are still completely dependent on nature and its constituents for our water, food, medicine, shelter, and energy. Mr. Speaker, say, at both Ministry of Waterways and Environment and Agriculture, we recognize the value of biodiversity and vibrant productive ecosystems as the foundation for thriving societies. And as such, at both ministries, we have started implementing nature-based solutions to protect against natural disasters with the use of vetiver grass for riverbank protection, mangroves for coastal protection from storm surge and rising tides. Through above, we are helping nature help us mitigate disasters by making use of natural processes and ecosystems services to build resilience. The speaker say, in the past, we have tried to address emerging societal challenges through hard gray infrastructure solutions. While these are expensive investments, it needs regular maintenance to maintain a level of safety. Furthermore, it doesn't protect during events beyond its design capacity. With increased frequency and magnitude of natural disasters, it is only advisable that we switch to more sustainable nature-based solutions, and that's what we are doing. By using nature-based solutions to solve our problems, we are also healing nature's ability to cope with climate change and supporting the livelihoods of many Fijians. Mr. Speaker, say, as governments across the world take drastic actions to get a grip on COVID-19 pandemic, save lives and reignite economies, 2020 has emerged as a year we realize that transformative change in our society is urgent and possible. Transformative change requires a paradigm shift, and doing things differently, implying that business as usual status quo is archaic and unacceptable and not a solution. To ensure transformative change, we need to mainstream biodiversity and ecosystem services across all sectors, meaning conservation and sustainable biodiversity integrated into planning and decision-making processes. Mr. Speaker, say, I had a discussion with our staff in the Ministry of Environment that we will need to make an effort to go and talk to other departments and ministries so that we can mainstream biodiversity issues in the policy making. We will assist as facilitators rather than just a police, environmental police. Mr. Speaker, say the current crisis illustrates the fact that if you are willing to change, change can happen quickly. This demonstrates that decades of climate change targets could have been achieved, biodiversity crisis averted, and a resilient economy, health communities, and a thriving healthy communities, and a thriving natural world was possible if only we were prepared to accept change. Mr. Speaker, say, please allow me to share insight into Fiji's biodiversity. According to the National Biodiversity Strategic and Action Plan 2020-2025, recent studies, Fiji has a 50.1% of its plant species of endemic status. Endemic status meaning, Mr. Speaker, say, that they are only found in Fiji and nowhere in the world. And that's why they call endemic, say, endemic plants, endemic animals, endemic species. 35 of the 166 birds in Fiji are endemic to Fiji, which includes Fiji petrel. 14 out of 32 endemic terrestrial reptile species, 40 out of 32 are endemic, meaning only found in Fiji. 6 known species of bats are only mammals in Fiji, endemic to Fiji. 2 known frogs, the Fiji ground frog and the Fiji tree frog, are endemic to Fiji, are only found in Fiji. An estimated 166 species of freshwater and estuarine fishes, 13 out of which, out of this 166, are endemic, only found in Fiji. Out of 2,031 marine fishes in Fiji, 33 are considered marine endemics. Mr. Speaker, say, it is evident from above that we have a lot to do if we want to maintain this species and therefore balance the ecosystem. Mr. Speaker, say, our existence is defined by the existence and safety and security of this ecosystem that we are part of. If they are safe, if they are protected, if they are looked after, our existence are also guaranteed. Safety of our existence is also guaranteed. Mr. Speaker, say, the species with high endemism represents habitats within ecosystem that are critical for protection and require management actions to safeguard it from ongoing and emerging threats. And it is and we need to protect these ecosystems, the indigenous forests. Mr. Speaker, say, my colleague, Honorable Nengamu, earlier this morning spoke about the forestry sector and their contribution, relentless work in terms of protecting our forests. Mr. Speaker, say, Fiji's forests comprise 85.3% of the nation's forests and continue to support the vast majority of countries' endemic fauna and flora. Mr. Speaker, say, I will not delve much on that, as my ministerial colleague did speak about that. But Fiji has 13 known hotspots within the Watoi Ra and Lomaiviti passage of particular importance to the migration pathway of Cetaceans. The ecological connectivity and integrity of ecosystems that are essential for the survival and well-being of migratory birds that needs to be conserved and protected. Honorable Speaker, threats to Fiji's biodiversity are many and they continue to evolve in terms of complexities and associated risks. As with our island neighbors, Fiji is continually confronted by the devastating effects of climate change. Mr. Speaker, say, it is evident that biodiversity and climate change are two sides of the same coin. Biodiversity is affected by climate change with negative consequences for human well-being, but biodiversity through the ecosystem services supports climate change mitigation and adaptation. Therefore, conserving and sustainably managing biodiversity is critical to addressing climate change. Both must be addressed in tandem if we are to increase resilience and protect biodiversity for future generations. Mr. Speaker, say, biodiversity supports our current efforts to reduce negative effects of climate change through carbon sequestration. Moreover, conserving intact ecosystems such as mangroves helps reduce the devastating effects of climate change, such as coastal inundation and storm surges. Mr. Speaker, say, while celebrating the International Day for Biological Diversity last week, The Ministry launched a number of initiatives and policy documents aimed at conserving our biodiversity. Honourable Mr. Speaker, say Fiji is home to some 250 endemic species, with more than 56% having reported as threatened and 32 as critically endangered. Common threats attributed include habitat loss, increase in invasive species, the changing climate affecting species population, distribution, resilience ability, vulnerability status, and biological characteristics. Mr. Speaker, say Fiji has committed to a number of conservation global frameworks to guide its conservation work on endemic and threatened species. The Conservation on Biological Diversity, the Conservation and International Trade on Endangered Species of Wild and Flora and Fauna, the Convention on Migratory Species are few that guide Fiji's policy priorities in implementation of targeted species program. To achieve targets of these conventions and agreements, we have recently launched policy directions protecting terrestrial marine biodiversity. Mr. Speaker, say we were on the beautiful island of Yandua and Yandua Tamba on the 21st of May last week to launch the iguana conservation policy aimed at conserving and protecting Fiji's endemic crested iguana species, four species that we have. Yandua Tamba is a stronghold for the species, containing approximately 98% of the world's population, estimated to be between 10,000 to 13,000 animals, and is the only legally protected population in Fiji. Yandua has close to 13,000 and another 1,000 in Mololo Island. And that's what we have in the entire world. And therefore, this crested iguana is endemic, only found in Fiji. Mr. Speaker, said through this policy, the Ministry translates the government's environment and biodiversity targets into actions, and it illustrates our leadership in protecting endangered species. Mr. Speaker, said I had met the members of the Vanua and Yandua Island and spoke to them about how, first of all, acknowledging and thanking them for allowing Yandua Tamba to be a sanctuary for the crested iguana. And secondly, did have a good talanoa with them in terms of how we can assist them in supporting their work on the island of Yandua, given that they have allocated that particular island as a sanctuary. Just this morning, I had a meeting with two PSs, PS Environment, PS Agriculture, putting into action and delivering on the assistance that we discussed on the island. And we decided that we will go with the assistance, in 3 to 4 weeks' time and provide them the support. Mr. Speaker, say, I was also with my team on the next day, on Friday, the Day of International Biodiversity, on Voroboro Island, closer to the Great Sea Reef, the Fiji's coral reef, to also again launch a policy on conservation and management of the Fiji's coral reefs, aimed at promoting the conservation and protection of Fiji's coral reefs and associated ecosystem. This policy furthers Ministry's leadership in biodiversity protection and national conservation efforts, delivering on our national biodiversity targets, as well as our commitments to ACHI targets and other associated conventions we are party to. Mr. Speaker, said, to further protect and manage our coral reef, we have just signed a letter of engagement that details the terms of engagement between the Ministry of Environment and Vulcan Incorporation to collaborate on the use of Allan Coral Atlas in Fiji for coral reef monitoring and management at no cost to us. The Allan Coral Atlas is building a database fed with satellite imagery that can detect changes in coral reefs and provide us the much needed early warning, giving us time to devise strategies to better manage our coral reefs. This collaboration will allow us to better understand the evolving state of our coral reefs and ensure that necessary action is undertaken to protect them. Mr. Speaker, say it is evident that, and I quote, you can't fix what you can't see. And hence the above collaboration with Vulcan Incorporation will allow us to monitor our coral reef from space via satellites, allowing government agencies and researchers and decision makers to make informed evidence-based decisions to conserve and protect our coral reefs that are incredibly threatened by activities on land. Mr. Speaker, say while the Ministry takes lead on ACHI targets, we through various national projects, including JEF-R2R, are getting various other government agencies, including agriculture, forestry, fisheries, waterways, and infrastructure, and other sectors that use the land and that often are the primary drivers of biodiversity loss, implement projects to reverse biodiversity loss, Such projects include reforestation program, strengthening locally managed marine protected areas, promoting nature-based solutions, riverbank stabilization, and also recently a project that was implemented by is being implemented by Ministry of Agriculture is to look after animals so that the biodiversity is protected, has been funded under the Jeff Ark Rich to Reef program. Mr. Speaker, say we as a nation have progressed significantly in our commitments to recognize the importance of Fiji's biodiversity and its contribution to national social security and economy. We are mindful, Mr. Speaker, say that our people's livelihood, particularly in the interior, rural, maritime division, are linked, intertwined with our nature, our biological resources. Fiji is party to a number of multilateral environmental agreements that provide an international framework towards protection, conservation, and sustainable use of biodiversity, natural resources, which in turn guides governments in developing tools for sustainable development and conservation purposes. As the Speaker said, the government has introduced a number of policies that recognize the critical importance of biodiversity as a natural solution to problems we face. But the climate change policy gives recognition to the critical role of ecosystems, such as wetland areas, mangrove, and our oceans as nature-based solutions to the effects of climate change. It calls for conservationists, practitioners, investors, planners, and economists to enhance collaboration in natural resource management practices to promote the protection of carbon sinks and buffer zones that addresses climate change stresses and risks. Mr. Speaker, say society around the world are increasingly recognizing and responding to the environmental challenge and looking up to the government to lead. Here in Fiji, we have rigorous environmental management legislation in place. What we need is synergy across sectors to realize our biodiversity and environmental targets. We need to take every opportunity to put biodiversity management at the top of the agenda. Mr. Speaker said, many still think this planet is ours to use as we like, demonstrating the willful ignorance of the importance of ecosystems to our well-being as well as other plant and animal species. We have massively undervalued subsidy provided by the environment. We need to stop thinking of biodiversity protection as a cost, but as an investment that goes hand in hand with other investments we have done to consolidate economic growth and national well-being. Mr. Speaker, say nature, its sounds, the trees, the birds, all of this provides us with a sense of identity, a sense of home, a safe place. I'm sure each of us will be able to recollect our time in nature, whether it's morning walks, sailing our oceans, farming our land, or simply nurturing our children to care for nature. These moments define who we are, where we belong. Losing our biodiversity means we lose our peace, we lose our joy, we lose our humanity, we lose ourselves. Mr. Speaker said, when it comes to biodiversity conservation, we all need to lead our communities. We need to demonstrate that everyone has a role. This is our legacy, our gift to generations to come. Thank you. Naka.